Hello, this is Haley McLaughlin with the League of Women Voters of Portland, and you are watching the Video Voters Guide. We, in conjunction with Metro East Community Media, are here to talk with candidates running for in the May 2020 primary election. With me today is Teresa Rayford, running for Mayor, City of Portland. Welcome, Teresa.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Let's get started. Please tell us a little bit about yourself, why you're running for this office, and what the unique characteristics you have among all the candidates for this office.
All right. Well, a little bit about myself. I was born here in Portland. Both of my parents were born here. My grandfather and his mom were actually born here. So that makes me like a fourth generation Oregonian. A little bit about myself. I'm a community organizer. I started an organization, nonprofit, called Don't Shoot Portland in response to my nephew's murder in downtown Portland when he was 19 years old. I decided to run for office because in my engagement since his death, I've had to reflect on my life and the disadvantages that I and other people in our city have had for generations. And in looking back at that, participating and promoting civic engagement, I still see that there's a lot of loopholes in regards to our engagement and our direct influence over policies and the way that we're served. And I want to change that. I think it's going to change because a lot of the things that we're hearing now and over the last decade was that we needed those most marginalized communities to be on the front line and to be helping us make the decisions. But the fact is that we can't continue to hear the broken promises. You know, and it's hard to go back into your community without the power that you're setting everyone up to believe that they're going to be a part of. And so, you know, we're looking at what Dr. King went through and many civil rights leaders in our generation. And we're saying, you know what, enough is enough. And let us be the change that has to be there for social change to happen.
That's great. Thank you. With the COVID-19 pandemic and the resulting devastation of small businesses, city employee layoffs, and housing displacement that will be with us for a long time, how would you seek to address the fallout, including the reduction in city revenue?
Absolutely. Well, I've already started addressing this fallout as soon as it happened. Of course, you know, the most marginalized and vulnerable communities needed a resource or at least a response. And all of us were waiting for our city to respond. So I started organizing through my nonprofit and with other partnerships to kind of seek those immediate mutual aid responses and to kind of document and make sure that people had information that was accessible for them so that they could start, like, depending on their community and what we could do here locally in the city of Portland before we have to wait for the federal government to do its response. And I think that the engineering of that type of work, it creates a social dynamic that brings in those corporate interests. It shows that instead of having communities competing against each other like landlords and renters, that you have a situation where they're working together or they're seeking solutions that matter to both of them because we see how vulnerable we all really are. And so with this response, I have a weekly show that I have with a health administrator giving out information. Yesterday or Wednesday, we had a district attorney on. Today, I'll be meeting online with a state representative and mostly just to engage community so that we can see where they are because there aren't a lot of answers. But there is a lot of necessity in engaging on these issues so that we're not just spending time social distancing without a dialogue or discussion or understanding.
Absolutely. So are you satisfied with the current structure of Portland city government? And if not, how would you change it?
I'm not satisfied with it. I think that we can do a lot more to engage civic participation in all demographics. My mother, she sits on the board of the senior center at Multnomah County. And during this election, I've noticed a lot of times where I don't see her in the room. And I'm like, what is the need of having her on a board or inviting communities to a statewide, you know, legislative day of, you know, of lobbying or to sit in work group committees or any type of involvement if you're not even thought of as a viable option for supporting the influence of policy or those that we're going to elect? I want to see regular general public people in some of these forums asking the questions when the labor community, tends to people like me as an organizer standing up for healthcare for all and 15 now. I needed to tell my community how important it was that they were fighting for those things, because being unionized was going to help my brother or anybody else that needed a job where they could actually pay some bills. Having fair wages matters to all of us, but there's a disconnect when it comes to bureaucracy seeking an opportunity to engage us. And so I want to build that out. I think that the strategies are in community engagement. I think that we're all relative, and especially now with COVID, we're all seeking answers and solutions that unite us while we're social distancing. And I've pretty much had to live my entire life this way. But I think that right now what we need to seek in a leader is someone that can unite us and that does not believe in division, because it doesn't serve any of us well. And I think that I've proven that through the work that I do, both politically and socially, to engage and educate community.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So how would you address the public's significant concerns about police-community relations, the use of deadly force, and officer accountability?
Well, right now in the country, people are talking about the use of force because we're trying to figure out how we police people during the social distancing era. And we know that marginalized communities, again, are going to be the ones most affected by that. And being a frontline person that has looked for the statewide legislation changes in the way that we hold our policing accountable, and that's as well as city and county. I think that what we're seeing now, the result of the need for services rather than authority over people, the need for our healthcare system to be funded and invested in, the need for housing, the need for critical care and education. I think that we're learning the measure of humanity that we've been missing out on. And when we've injured people with violence and brutality because it is a systemic practice, we know that that is doing more harm than good. So I think a lot of what we're learning now, we need to take these tools and we need to help them help us evolve in society. Because this is a very drastic situation that we're dealing with right now, running for a campaign at a time when you're still advocating for yourself and advocating for others. It makes you mindful of these things seriously, you know?
Absolutely. Thank you. To wrap up, the city's park systems face serious financial challenges, even more so since the closures caused by the pandemic. What ideas do you have for securing the financial stability of our well-loved park system?
Well, because of COVID, and not even just because of COVID, we need to reinvest in our park systems the way they were invested in when I was a child. We used to go to the parks for our lunch programs. We had the reading tree. Scholastic books were there. You had all these different recreational services and programs that were free to the public so that everybody could afford it. And there wasn't a situation where some kids had to come only on a Thursday to use swimming pools or things like that. And what we saw in the last administration, again, cutting the parks. I learned maybe 6 or 7 years ago at the Juvenile Justice Center, when we were sitting at a table talking about the Joint Terrorism Task Force and how it could help us identify criminals at a young age. One of the people there, a social worker, said when we cut the parks program, we received juvenile clients into the jail system at a rate of 30 to 70% because they didn't have anywhere to go. And even traveling to the park, when you know that you're living in a community that is not economically sound, where there's no investment, you can be criminalized. And we criminalize children, we criminalize poverty, and we criminalize people of color. So I think that restructuring and re-entering investment in our parks, we have safe spaces for families. And once families have places to come together, society changes because those relationships have a place where they're able to be developed. And so hopefully we'll get to where we need to be, but we got to get past where we are now. And hopefully people will think, you know, along the lines of what type of leader do we need to get us past this? And who do we have as an option? I hope they take me.
Thank you, Teresa.
Thank you.
This has been the Video Voters Guide. Thank you for watching. The primary election is Tuesday, May 19th. Be sure to inform yourself about the candidates and the ballot measures and exercise your right to vote.